YouTubers, and welcome to this review and introduction to analog oscilloscopes. So the oscilloscope I've got here is the GW Instec GDS 630 FC. Now I said introduction and review because this is the first time I've had my hands on an analog oscilloscope since I was at college. So it's going to be a good time, I think, to actually introduce some of the basics about oscilloscopes, because this has very fundamental, simple controls. I think it's a very good way to learn how to use an oscilloscope. Through that process, we're going to learn the kind of pros and cons of an analog oscilloscope versus a normal digital oscilloscope. And at the end of the video, I'll even talk about digital phosphor oscilloscopes, because that's kind of a hybrid or in between the two of these. So this video might go into a part two, depending on the length. So we'll talk about this little beast. I went and purchased this off Amazon. You can get these analog scopes, the GW Instec, are also rebranded as Isotec. So I know Isotec do sell these as well. They don't sell, as far as I know, they don't sell this particular model, because this one has got this little LCD which actually gives you the time base and voltage levels and a hardware frequency counter, which I thought was a kind of nice addition. At the end of this, we'll also discuss whether, if you're a beginner to electronics, would you necessarily go for something like this? And I think we'll probably sum up and find out that probably not. Because for the price, you're going to perhaps be better off with an entry-level digital oscilloscope. But having said that, I think you'll find that a lot of folks who do serious analysis of signals will say that having both an analog and a digital scope can provide a lot of value. And that's where we're going to understand their performance differences and how they work. So let's take a closer look. Right, so the first thing I want to do is just give you an idea of footprint, because it can be quite deceiving, and it's something that you obviously need to be aware of when you are considering or looking at analog oscilloscopes. This one from GW Instec has a very compact footprint in the front. As you can see, it's fairly narrow. However, because it's got a cathode ray tube, those are obviously heavier and they require a fair bit of space. So if you look at the size of the box, it goes a long way back. If you compare it to my Agilent, how nice and neatly the footprint of the actual Agilent. And if we come and have a look at something like the Rigol, now this is the DS1052, but the DS1102 has got a very similar or the same footprint, and that scope is 100 megahertz. So I just wanted to bring this to your attention, because this analog scope cost about $440 odd. But you can get the 100 megahertz version of this, so the 1102E will cost you under $400. It'll cost you about $380, $390. However, again, and this is something I've highlighted when I was talking about performance, that scope over there is operating at 1 gigasample per second, but that's at its best performance. And obviously I've highlighted the issues with digital scopes, and obviously that they're blind a lot of the time, they're trying to process a signal. Whereas an analog scope, for the most part, is working real time. The signal is coming in through an amplifier, through a triggering system, and it's being displayed real time on your CRT. There are certain, obviously, performance issues, which I'm going to try and demonstrate, but just something to be aware of. Right, so here's a closer look at the GW Instec. As noted, the one kind of interesting, unique feature about it, one may call it gimmicky, but what it does, it has the time-based figures up here in this LCD, as well as a hardware frequency counter, and then your volts per division for both channel 1 and channel 2. The beautiful thing about an analog oscilloscope like this is that what you see is what you get. So basically all the controls on the front are therefore used for operating the scope. There's no hidden menus or anything like that. Once you understand their basic operation, you then have the full operation of the scope. This analog scope is really simple in comparison to some of the nicer, older Tektronix scopes. And we'll talk about that, because I think ultimately, if you really want to invest in a good analog scope, the older scopes, which have technology which is still current today, really, for diagnosis, you can have them for very good prices on eBay, but we'll talk about that later.
This scope does come with a certificate of traceable calibration from GW Instech. I do know that as well. If you do go and get the Isotech version of these, you can go and get a current Isotech or RS components certificate of calibration as well. It does come with a set of probes. These are both times 10 and times 1, and it obviously comes with a set of 2 for the 2 channels. It does come with a nice user manual, and the one thing you'll note on the front here, which is something we'll talk about, it says it's a dual trace oscilloscope. So dual trace means that it can display 2 traces or 2 signals. It is a 2 channel oscilloscope. You do get dual beam oscilloscopes, and what the difference there is that this CRT or cathode ray tube only has a single beam, and if you're trying to display 2 signals, it has to do some clever manipulation to display both of them at the same time. So we're going to talk about that. What it either displays does an alternate display where the trace goes across the screen for one and then goes across, alternates and does the other trace, or it chops between the two, but we'll talk about that. A dual beam scope has 2 beams where it can separately display one signal on one beam and another signal on the other beam, and it doesn't have to alternate between the two. Just a quick peek at the kind of information here. If you want to kind of pause and have a closer look at these specifications, then do. But obviously the kind of often the time-based figures of a cheaper analog scope like this aren't going to rival that of some of the digital scopes. And we're going to talk about something you need to take into consideration when you're choosing the bandwidth of your scope and what can be displayed on a scope. It then has a host of kind of standard features, but the other interesting specification which you might want to consider if you are looking at analog scopes is the CRT. So it'll give you the type of the CRT, and it'll give you something here called the acceleration voltage, which is approximately 2 kilovolts in this case. Now that voltage is used to kind of accelerate the beams or electrons onto the phosphor on the front of the CRT. The higher your frequencies get, you're going to find that your display dims, so your trace, because it's going so fast, doesn't have enough energy to display the trace. And case in point, I've got a square wave on display here, and you can quite clearly see the top of the square wave. The vertical part of the square wave, you can't really see. So as soon as you have a scope which is required to show a higher bandwidth and your trace speed needs to be faster, you need a higher voltage to be able to give more kinetic energy to the electrons hitting the phosphor, so that more energy is radiated out from the CRT so you can display those higher frequencies. Okay, so I'm going to introduce you to the kind of knobs and the features on this so we can go through, explain and understand those, and then have a comparison versus a digital oscilloscope. But just to show you, I've now just got a one channel one up with a sinusoidal wave going at about 1 kilohertz, and as you can see, it's got the frequency counter over here, which is just about showing the correct frequency. It's only a smidgen off. You can see the time base, and then we've got our volts per division. So the beautiful thing here is if I go and change, and just note this update on the actual CRT, how quick it is. Often you're going to note with the cheaper digital scopes, as soon as you start making these kinds of changes, because there's processing happening in the background and it's digitizing, there's a lot more happening, whereas this is just throwing the signal onto the screen, obviously barring going through an amplifier and triggering. So it happens very quickly, and it's a pleasure to sit and work on an analog scope after having used a digital scope for the time that I have. But as I change the time base here, you can see the time base setting is shown in the actual display over here. If I change the volts per division as well, you can see that updating in the actual screen over there. On some of the older scopes, you'd have that noted on the actual dials, the analog dials. This has got obviously a digital control for an analog scope, but they would literally have analog dials as well with the readings around the actual dials, or they would display them on the actual CRT. So I think this method actually of having the actual display here, for me, I think works and is quite functional. You then obviously got your standard knobs where you can go and change your vertical position on the display. And if we go to the time base over here, you can obviously change the horizontal position of the signal that you're looking at as well. some of the different controls that you've got on an analog scope, you've got something down here called intensity. You can change the intensity of the actual trace across the CRT. And that may be helpful sometimes when you're looking for little glitches or noise. You want to change the intensity, or if you've got the trace running at a different speed, you might want to turn up the intensity so you can see the wave a little better. It has a focus knob as well. If I turn that, you can see the actual wave goes out of focus. So you can actually set the focus correctly. It's got something, a pot tucked away there called trace rotation. So that literally aligns it correctly with the graticule lines that you're going to take your measurements against. I'll just note that when I say take measurements, this oscilloscope, very simple. It doesn't even have your lines for taking measurements. You have to obviously do that off the graticule lines yourself. It does have an interesting feature here, auto time base. If I push that, it'll actually set the time base. I'll go and change the frequency of the wave. So I've gone and changed, if I push the auto time base, it'll actually go and select a time base to show you the signal nicely within the actual display. We then have the triggering. It's got your normal auto, it's got normal. We've got the trigger level. It doesn't have something to show you where the trigger is set. You kind of just have to intuitively figure that out. With obviously in the normal mode, if I'm out of triggering, it's not going to show anything. If I come back into the kind of triggering level over here and then go out, you can see it disappears. In auto mode, it's obviously going to trigger. It's going to show something all the time on the display. Unlike a digital oscilloscope, which will leave the last known captured trigger, this just has a trace going across, and if I bring it down and obviously hit the trigger point, then I've obviously got the trace triggered nicely on the display. You've also got a TV mode and a TVH for obviously looking at analog TV signals. I, at this point in time, operated most of the time in auto. You've then got a source. You can trigger off channel 1, you can trigger off channel 2 line for your line voltage. Or external, you've got an external input as well. You've obviously then also got your positive or negative slope that you either triggering off the front end positive or the negative part of the slope of your signal. It does have a 10 times magnification, and this can be quite handy if you want to look at complex waves and want to get in closer. You can see the trace over there. Or once we're going up in frequency, if we want to have a closer look at the wave, and I'll just demonstrate that. So although I'm not testing the scope's capability here because I'm not here at the top end of its frequency bandwidth, if I was, and literally the time base didn't allow me to kind of see enough of the wave, I could also use that to kind of zoom into the actual more of the wave. But you can see here, and this is one of the downsides, I've got a light behind to kind of help with the lighting. As with a normal CRT TV, background lighting obviously does pose a problem versus a digital scope, but you can see that the trace has dimmed. Obviously, when I bring it back, you've got a bit more intensity there. I'll just bring up the intensity a little more. You've also then got this horizontal button over here, or variation. You can go and pull in and see more of the wave. But once you start adjusting that, your time-based calibration is then going out. So you're just doing that. If you want to see more of the signal, you can do that. And it's got the word cal on the side here. You bring it back to cal because then that takes it back to the kind of its calibrated time base. You've got the same thing for your voltage level as well. You can vary that. If you want to bring more into view on the scope, you can change that. But then obviously your volts per division is going out, and you can take it back to where it says cal because that's the calibrated setting. What you can also do, I mean, I've put a test signal on here, and if you note, if you happen to have a test signal and realize things are slightly out, in theory you could use that to go and set the calibration to set the wave exactly right if you want to do precise measurements. So that's one quick handy feature. It's a kind of onboard in front of you calibration, not obviously necessarily meant for that. If you want to properly calibrate, you'd need to go into the actual scope itself. We've then got a mode button, which gives us, you can choose just channel 1, just channel 2, or both channels, or you can do add channel 1, channel 2. You've also got a channel invert if you want to kind of do subtraction as well, if you're doing kind of differential measurements. We've got a obviously a button here which gives you a ground, which will just literally ground your signal, so for 0 volts, and that will allow you, if you like, to go and set your trace exactly on the zero line. DC is the one you're going to most commonly work in. That's going to show you the complete waveform coming in without any changes. Going to AC will remove any DC offset, so it'll in essence zero the actual signal for you. And I'll just demonstrate that. If I've got that signal there, I'm going to apply DC offset. So as I'm giving it a negative DC offset, so it's moving out of the actual range of the view. I could bring it up, or if I go to AC, you'll see it brings it up to the center here. Now the handy thing is, if you're looking at certain signals where the voltage, you've got your time base or your volts per division set, and you cannot bring something down into view, then that can be very handy, particularly if you're looking at the kind of ripple on a filter capacitor. It may be running at a higher voltage and you can get in the display by setting it to AC. You then center that so you can have a look at your actual AC ripple without the DC offset. Right, to allow me to kind of better show things, I'm going to switch off the backlight just so we get a better show up from the actual CRT itself. The next thing I want to demonstrate is the trace and how the trace works. As I said, it's a single beam coming from the back of the CRT. And to be able to show you two signals like this, the sinusoidal wave and the square wave I've got here, it has to do one of two things. It either has to send the trace across to first trace the sinusoidal wave, it then alternates and does the square wave. Or it can do something called a chop, where it switches in between the two as it's going across in a scan. And just to demonstrate that operation and which one you choose, I'll slow the actual frequency or the time base down so we can see what's going on. So if I start slowing things down, can you actually see now that the alternating is sending the beam at the top and then at the bottom? Very clear there if I slow it down to that speed. So that is when it's doing alternate. If I switch to chop, it looks as though it's kind of got two beams, but in reality it hasn't. It's just chopping up and down quickly between them. Where this comes into play, I'll take it back to alternate. Now once you get to 2 milliseconds, now if you have a look at that signal, you can actually see the flickering because the time base is not high, so your trace is not going across at high speed. And that's where, because the trace is spending all the time tracing at the top and then coming to the bottom, the phosphor is kind of losing its energy and display ability of the top trace, and likewise for the bottom one. So when you've got a slower signal and your time base is kind of 2 milliseconds or slower, if you then go to chop, as you can see, now you're seeing a little bit of interference because of the frame rate on my camera, but that looks far better. It looks perfect to me, as opposed to what you're seeing right there. So that's where the chop is better. Once you start stepping up your time base, however, you're actually going to get a better display once you go to the alternate. You get a brighter display. You can't see that clearly here, but it certainly is the case. So that's what your alternate and your chop is for. The next thing we'll talk about is triggering. So the triggering modes are up here on this little switch over here. I've got it set to auto, so it'll trigger anyway, whether it's the trigger level is set correctly. And at the moment, the source I've got set to channel 1. So I am triggering off the sinusoidal wave. Now, because both of these signals coming in both on channel 1, channel 2 are at the same frequency, the trigger is able to kind of stabilize and show and display both signals quite nicely. However, and this is a feature that even my Agilent doesn't have, my Agilent only allows you to set a trigger off either channel 1 or channel 2. What happens if the frequency, let's say, changes of one of these? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to change the frequency of channel 1 on the sinusoidal wave. As I change it up, note what has happened to channel 2, the square wave. You can see it's actually now going out of sync because it's not triggering. So whether I go and change the trigger level or not, that's not going to bring it in because the trigger level is only set to channel 1. But this has a little trick up its sleeve. It's got something, a button over here called Trig Alternate. So what it does, it'll alternate and pick up the trigger from both signals. So if I go and push that, I then bring stability back to channel 2. So a very nice feature that you can have two signals of varying frequency and get the scope to trigger off both of them, which my Agilent can't do. Some of the more advanced analog scopes, and that would be case in point for perhaps some of the digital ones, even have a second time base. You can have a different time base for each of your signals.